Can you tell us a little bit about your childhood and upbringing? You were born and bred in Melbourne. Can you tell us a little bit about your culture, your background and your family life?
Okay, I grew up to a Lebanese family, Lebanese parents. I grew up in Melbourne, so I was pretty much country Victoria. We started, like, that's where we first
family's did. Really small. There's only me, my brother and my sister. And yeah, so we don't have much family or relatives in Australia.
And we have a lot of family friends, but mainly we grew up with very Australian neighbours and, you know, an Australian upbringing.
What was it like living in Melbourne and why the move to Sydney?
Oh, I lived in Melbourne for a long time. So I got married and moved to Sydney 11 years ago.
And so. You're married to Albert?
Yes, Albert. He's comes from a very traditional Lebanese family, but also very small. So it's only him and his sister.
What was it like in terms of your views of marriage in Lebanese culture? Is it, do you find your own partner or is it, do parents get involved in the process? What is it like?
Well, with us, our parents let us find our own partner. They never really said, oh, usually they'll bring someone and they'll say, oh, you know, these, you got an option? Well, but no, it wasn't with us. Like, our parents didn't even focus on marriage. It was more about our career, like, just go do stuff that you love. That's how we were always raised. I don't think marriage was a big thing.
When did you know you wanted to be a comedian or a fashion designer? What was it like being a little girl in Melbourne and what did you always aspire to be?
Oh, I wanted to be a chef. So I became a chef. Yeah, so I was a chef for 10 years. And fashion didn't come till later, until I travelled America and then I realised that I wanted to get into fashion. I got into fashion and it just became a job, not like I wanted to be a fashion designer. I sort of like fell into fashion design because I had to create and develop new things for the store. So that's how that happened and that's what I keep doing. But comedy didn't come later till I was probably, it was only like 3 years ago, 4 years ago that I wanted to be a comedian. And I started to do courses and then that's how it came.
You've changed careers three times, or should I say you juggle three careers, from a chef to fashion designer and now comedian. How do you manage it all?
Well, now I just cook for my kids. That's as much as the chef part that I do. But fashion, it's just, me and my husband are a pretty good team. So we do that together because it's like a family business. Comedy is, I don't know how I get up at 6 a.m. and start writing and then I do that for the first 3 hours of my day because I won't be able to do it any other time. And then it's shop mode till around 3 and then it's kids mode from 3 onwards.
Did you have any fears in entering the comedy world coming from, you know, your background, being Muslim, being a female and obviously, you know, copying backlash in the community? Did you have any fears?
No, I didn't. And the reason is because growing up in a real Australian lifestyle, like we used to go to counter meals at the local pub, right? So a lot of our Aussie friends, they would take us down to the local pub. So we'd always be hanging out there, having fun. And it might be weird to say, but it sort of like felt normal. So then to go down to a bar or to a pub and do stand-up, it was like the people that you've always hung out with. So it wasn't a big thing. I think I have more fear going to a Lebanese wedding than going to doing stand-up. And I think the first night I did stand-up, we were supposed to do it with our class because I was part of a comedy class. And the guy that was teaching us, his grandmother died in New York, so he had to go, he was Jewish, so he had to go and get his share of the cut. And I was like, he wanted to continue the course 2 weeks later. I was like, stuff this, man, I'm going on stage. So I went to the Laugh Garage and I just went on stage and just did what I was learning. And I thought, this is awesome.
And what about Albert being your driving force as your partner? What is his thoughts throughout your journey as a fashion designer and also, of course, as now a comedian?
I think the fashion was just keep it going because it pays the bills, right? Whereas the comedy, He was like, oh, she's going to get shot. He was always worried that I'm going to get backlash from the community and all this sort of stuff. And I think I got better with my jokes through development. So at the start, I was really raw. And I was like saying stuff that you would not say, like it would give you a death sentence. So I had to really change that. And I think I started off being very angry because I still like did stand up to get out of this depression I was falling into. And then, so it was very, I was like a bit of anger. And then I realized that I could take the anger and turn it into laughter instead of shock comedy. So then I had to learn all that. And then that's when I had to change.
What comedians or people have shaped your views on becoming a comedian? Who do you aspire to be, and who inspires you?
Oh, there's so many now, but like at the start it was definitely Chris Rock. Like he was everything, and Eddie Murphy. Like they were like, wow, they're like the cream of the crop, you know. And then now there's like other comedians that you hang out with and you think, oh, I want to be like them. Like Steve Hughes, this guy's awesome. And there's a lot of comedians that haven't been discovered and you just think, man, where'd they get that joke from? That's really funny. So there's a lot out there, you know, that's not mainstream that are really, really hilarious.
What has been your proudest moment up until now in your life, personal and professional?
My proudest moment? My children? Probably. You know, they always seem to come first. And having now four kids, it's like I'm teaching them to do, because, you know, I always wanted to be an actress and it was just forbidden, you know. My mum wouldn't let me. So now, you know, I've got my daughter doing stand-up comedy at school. I'm getting her doing, you know, what do they have? They have speak, you know, how they go public speaking and, you know, get her to write her feelings on paper. I teach her to be creative, you know, all of them. So I make sure that all that comes out, that they learn how to express their emotions. Because to be a writer, that's what you got to learn. And I think that's key. And if I can teach them this, well, the doors will open for them in so many ways.
How do you feel you've coped with the stereotype that the public may have imposed on you, and also now through your comedy? How do you break those barriers down? What's your secret?
I don't care. I don't care. I don't care what they say. Like, it never worries me. Like, it doesn't worry me what they say, you know. And if they do say stuff that is, you know, racist or whatever, I just turn it into a joke. It just gives me more material. Bring it on.
What's been the most common stereotype that people have imposed on you?
Oh, that we're oppressed. You know, that we're, our husbands have got two wives. You know, we're not allowed to go out. We have no lifestyle. You know, all this sort of stuff. We can't speak English. You know, things like that.
What's the message you'd like to convey to the world through your comedy?
Oh, I'm probably more Australian than you guys. So don't go there. You know, I'll probably make better damper. I don't know.
What makes you happy on your day-to-day?
Anything to do with comedy, any writing, anything to do with doing that, that's what makes me happy.
What's your starting point? Like, when you script writing, where do you do it? How do you do it? How do you process your flow?
Okay, I've always got a Google Drive file open on my phone. So anything that comes to my thought, like anything that comes to my head, like customer or my kids or something's happened throughout the day, I'll write it down. And then I look back at it the next day. And then once you've got the thought, the joke is a three step. So it's just easy just to turn it into a joke. Just, you know, put your feelings into it and you got the joke. So you got to write everything down. And you can't write notes. You can't write coffee. Because you go back to it the next day going, what happened with the coffee? You're going to write why you wrote the coffee down, why it's important. And that's it. You just got to keep writing every day. And that's the trick.
What do your children think about you being a super mum, being a designer that pays the bills as well now as getting on stage and saying what she feels? What do you think your children feel about that?
Oh, they think I'm not funny. They think I should be home cleaning. I don't know. They don't understand it. They just think anyone can be a comedian, anyone can stand on stage. Why are you so funny? Why, you know, they have no idea of what I do when I go out on stage. So they don't know. They just see it as mum.
Have you always been hilarious?
Yeah, I was always the funny kid at school. But that's different than being a comedian. You can always be funny, but to put it on paper and make a wide audience laugh, like, that's massive. That's not easy to do.
How hard was it to actually get an agent to notice you? And congratulations, you've been signed. Yeah. So tell us a little bit more about those plans.
Thank you. Mate, it's so hard to get an agent to get you. Like, I think you really got to know where you want to go and what you want to do. But agents just don't take on anyone. Like, you have to be something for them to take you on. And
what do you feel has made you stand out for an agent?
I think, well, when I worked for Gruen and I wrote for the show, I think I stood out there and everyone was like, mate, we didn't realise that this girl could write like this. So just them helping me going, mate, what are you doing? What are you doing in Punch Bowl selling dresses when you should be writing for TV shows? So I think they help you. There's a lot of people that will help you get there if the talent's there.
So you've been 5 years working towards this goal. Where would you like to see yourself in another 5 years?
I have my own TV show. Or be on the radio, that's probably the goal.
Do you have any ideas what the show would be?
Yeah, Graham Norton, have you seen that show? Oh, he sits on the lounge and he's got all the celebrities come, he's really funny. So that's the show that I want, or just my own radio show.
Now, you've mentioned you might be going to mentor youth all over the world. Did you ever dream that you, Frida Deguise, would be shaping the world and changing youth?
No, I had no idea. So to be invited to the Maldives to speak to the Muslim youth and get them into acting and get them more into the arts, oh, I didn't think that I was the type. Like, why there's so much other people that have gone to school, been to NIDA and all those acting places and done that. And for me to be chosen to do that is pretty big. But mate, I have the experience now. I know that I can do it.
Did you have any formal training to equip you with the skills to do comedy, or is this just something that's flown through your veins?
No, I have definitely had so much training. I did 2 comedy courses, and then in the end, I have a coach from LA. We write every week. He wrote for the Jay Leno show for 8 years, worked on Murphy Brown, wrote for The Late Show, Conan. And he's written movies that have made it into the big screen. And so I have private tutoring with him on a weekly basis for the last 3 years. So that's, and he's taught me how to write. So that's, yeah, it's cost me a lot of money. But, yeah, now I can write really fast, really jokes really quickly and whatever the topic is. So, yeah, definitely formal training. You have to.
Your audience is a mixture of people, and you seem to appeal to a unisex audience and quite funny at that. Do you see more Muslim women attending your shows, and is that something you'd like to see more of?
Yeah, I'm starting to get a lot of Muslim women coming to the show, and I didn't think that because I was always more to Mount Druitt and Penrith type of client, like, you know, the real Bogans and Aussies and... So to see them come out and watch all the shows, it's awesome. Like, now I'm starting to have a following, and yeah, I didn't know how they would take me. But man, when you get a bunch of Lebanese girls together, we're all saying the same thing and doing the same thing. We're pretty much normal, you know.
You created waves in the fashion scene when you walked into, you know, launching your collection at Fashion Palette with your T-shirt that had a very bold writing on it that, you know, you're a fashion threat, not a terror threat. What were you trying to convey with that message?
I think fashion is very stereotypical. You got to be this certain look. You got to be this certain person. You know, you got to have the fake lips, the eyelashes, the Botox, the nose job, and you got to fit into that look and be that person and be that size zero. And I am not that person, and I'll never be that person, and I don't want to be that person. So I was trying to show people that.
Yeah, I'm Muslim and I'm overweight and I can still create good clothes. And no, I'm not a terrorist like you probably think I am. I am a fashion designer, so, and I think that T-shirt did the job.
It certainly did. And how do you feel fashion designers that you've worked with see you now, that you've got the comedy and the fashion together?
Oh, I don't think, there's not much, I don't know if they know who I am, but it's, I don't want to be the Alex Perry or anything like that. Like, that's not what I'm doing. I'm designing fashion because I like it. But, I mean, you know, there's already an Alex Perry and there's already a, you know, a Jatan and all that sort of stuff. And I love what they do. They're all awesome. But I don't know. I just see that I'm making a collection that's sellable. That's all.
What's the most important thing to you in life? And what, if this was your last day on this earth, what would you want to achieve?
Oh, make my kids good kids. Probably make them adaptable and make sure that they grow up sensible and they're not racist and they don't, you know, I don't want them to talk about other religions, other cultures, and it's not what they should do. You know what I mean? There's so much more to life. And that's your career. And I think you want to make a difference to your people, do good in your job, and let everyone respect you, you will go far.
What makes you tick?
Not much anymore. I think that's a sign of getting old. I don't know what makes me tick. Not much. Not much anymore.
Well, you obviously get a kick of making people laugh.
Yeah. Oh, well, that's what makes me happy, I guess. Yeah, that's the best feeling on earth, making people laugh.
Would you say going solo in comedy was your breakthrough or touchstone moment to know that, hey, I've made this, I'm on the stage, I'm on my own? What feelings do you get when you go on that stage and deliver?
Oh, when I did my Fringe? Oh, yeah, it's like, yeah, finally, that's, you know, can take that off your list. Yeah, because you've got an hour of material in 3 years. They say that you only write 5 minutes a year. I've got an hour of material in a year and it worked. So, hey, that's an achievement and a half. And it was awesome because everyone was buying tickets to see you. Even there were people waiting at the door. They couldn't even get in, you know. So it's just huge.
Your latest show was named Outspoken. Obviously, the name speaks for itself. But what was that message that you were trying to get away from this show? You've done about four, and I'm sure you'll be doing many more. What would that show mean to you?
Outspoken was more about I can say what I want when I want and build a bridge and get over it if you're offended. So that's what Outspoken was about, and I had the freedom to say whatever I want when I wanted. It was my stage. So even I met some producers that came and saw that show and they said, oh, you're not afraid to say what you want, are you? And that was the show. That's, I can do anything. So, and the next show that I'm doing now is the Comedy Festival, which is called AKA Wogan, which is the Wogbogan. And that's about me, about like how I grew up and why I am the Wogbogan and my lifestyle, the way I live and, you know, all that sort of stuff, you know.
Your household is full of people, I'm sure. And guests, how is your life now compared to what it was in Melbourne? Has it changed much?
Oh, no, it's still the same. We're really quiet. Like, it's only me and my husband and the kids, my dad, sometimes my mum. Really quiet lifestyle. Like, we don't really do much. So, and I think that you got to live like that to do everything else. You can't have the social life and then run a business and be a comedian. Like, you just can't. You have to balance it all because you need to write, you need time to design. And so, yeah, no, it's really quiet. The kids are loud. That's it.
What would you advise young comedians, upcoming comedians like yourself? What advice would you give them?
You got to write every day. That's the key to becoming a comedian. And there's a thing that Jerry Seinfeld does. It's called Don't Break the Chain, which means that on your calendar you cross off with an X, the day that you write and the day that you don't write, it's left blank. That means you've broken the chain. So you got to go through the whole month with writing every day. And you have to write. If you don't write, you're going to get nowhere.
How would Frida Deguise like to be remembered as your legacy?
Oh, as Australia's first Muslim female stand-up comedian, I think that's... And being a news presenter, being on TV and being on the radio. So those three things are all right.
So you're taking over the world step by step and doing that quite marvellously with a wonderful following, with 30,000 views just recently on your latest interview. That is phenomenal. So congratulations once again to you, all of your achievements. And lastly, where do you want to go with this show? Like, what is the final bang for Frida Deguise? What's the next? What can we expect and anticipate for the next show?
I think after I do this show, I'll probably go to Edinburgh and do the comedy festival there. And then, you know, it's just getting to America, I think. Getting on The Daily Show, like Ronnie Chang, or, you know, just doing something there in America on, you know, doing 5 minutes. Once you've done that, you made it. That's it. So that's probably where I want to go.
And Frida, you've also been involved in talent shows, one being Australia's Got Talent. What was that like? Being part of that, getting an invite, what's the criteria?
It was like just being accepted for the audition was big because they scouted me. So there were 12 comedians or 10 comedians we had to audition, and only three of us got through per state. So that was big. And then going down to do Australia's Got Talent in Melbourne was even bigger because you see how it's so organised. And so many producers everywhere and everyone organising everything, and everything is pre-shoot. Like, you think it's live, you think it's not. Nah. So that was really big. I didn't get through. It was a bit of a stuff up on stage. They didn't introduce me, so no one knew what I was really saying or doing. But in the end, the experience was massive. Like, after I did that, I realised that, shit, you can do anything. This is nothing, you know. This is like... To do it in front of 800 people was big. And after I had finished, you know, I got so many compliments from Eddie Perfect and Kelly Osbourne. I mean, Eddie Perfect said, an industry that's full of men, and to have a woman in the mix like you is really refreshing. Kelly Osbourne said that I'm fighting the biggest war on terror with laughter. And then after I got off stage, Husey was on the side and he sort of like moved the cameras over and told him to go away, and he said, you listen here, and because you don't give up, he said, because he said, this place isn't for us, it's not for comedians. He said, you know, it's hard for us comedians out there. He said, you just keep going, and he goes, you're hilarious. He goes, so keep going. And so when you do stuff like that, you can't cry for very long. So it was big. It's you learn heaps. Like, it's a course in itself.
Is being a comedian profitable? Is there much money in this industry?
I think when you make it, there's heaps of money. Like, I don't know, I haven't felt nothing yet. We don't even get paid yet. But I think, yeah, when you start to make it, you know, TV, radio, writing for shows, it's all going to accumulate. So I think there's a bit of money in it.
Do you think you need the branding and marketing and an agent to represent you as being the next step? Or is the raw talent enough?
No, you definitely need an agent. You know, I had someone tell me once that you don't, you can do it on your own, but no way, you need an agent. And they know how to market you, because at the end of the day, you are a product and they need to sell you. So yeah, you need to find the right agent for yourself.
What did you look for in an agent when you were considering representation?
Well, I didn't look for any. They found me. No, look, I knew which agency I wanted, and that was because this agency only deals with radio and TV, and that's what I wanted to do. So I had to get in there because that's where I wanted to go. So you need to know, what do you want to do? Do you want to do corporate? Do you want to do festival shows? Do you want to do your own DVDs? Like, what is it? And once you know that, you know who to go with.
Has your career aspirations interfered with your personal life in any way?
It has. I have no social life. So it's all about working and, you know, not having the influences of people interfering in your life. So you've got to be dead focused. Like, it becomes your life. And being a mother of four, I have to work my ass off to make sure that these kids are fed. My husband goes, Yeah, all right. Just, you never know when you're going to get the call. Just make sure the house is clean and the food is on the table.
How does Frida Deguise relax?
As soon as I get home, I'll lie on the couch. That's it. And watch all the cooking channels. That's it.
So you're still connected to your cooking life. It's still there and that kind of relaxes you.
Yeah, I watch Come Dine With Me like nonstop. Like, it's a comedic cooking show. Yeah, it's funny.
Do you ever get a break?
No, only when I go to China. That's it. It's the only break I get. Yeah.
And do you ever get me time away from your family and your husband?
No, because me time is them. There's no time on my own. It's boring.
Do you have any pet hates?
From who? Like, just things. I used to have a lot of pet hates, but pet hates have become jokes. So the more pet hates I have, the better my jokes get. So I enjoy that. Like, a lady this morning screamed at me in the car, like, who taught you how to drive? And I just waved to her. I was like, okay, that's a joke of the day. Like, she didn't even have the guts to slow down. She screamed out at me while she was driving 40 kilometres. It's like, mate, if you're that tough, slow down and look at me in the eye and say that you ain't going to do that in Punch Bowl.
What's it like living in Punch Bowl?
I love this place. You know, there's everyone's. You know, it's like Little Lebanon, and everything's accessible. So it's a great place.
If there's one thing you could change in the comedy industry, what would it be?
We need more comedy clubs, and we need more sitcoms on TV. More Australian funny sitcoms. We really don't have anything besides the Habibs. So, yeah, we need more sitcoms. There's a lot of talent out there. And we shouldn't be afraid of putting comedy on TV.
Last question. Do you have any regrets at all?
Probably just my weight gain. Other than that, I'm fine.
Is this attributed to your fine cooking?
No, this is kids, four kids. They made me put on the weight. I hardly eat. There's no time.
Was this your choice? Did you always dream to have four kids?
I don't know. They just came. I don't know. I love kids. I don't know. I never said how many I want.
What's your ingredient to being the super mum that you are?
I don't think I'm a super mum. I think there's a lot of mums that do a lot more than I do. But I don't know. You just got to be organised. Yeah, I think that's the key.
Thank you very much for your time, Frida. It's always a pleasure, and we look forward to seeing you in your future endeavours.
Thank you for having me.